You're watching the NHL Stanley Cup playoff from Pittsburgh on NBC Sports, presented by Edge Shave Gel. Just an early turnover in a basketball game, a little snafu. Now we go with Mike and Sid.
Sid, what kind of urgency does your team have today for this one? You have to put these guys away.
They have to be desperate, and we know they're going to be desperate. They were last game, and I think our desperation is going to be there today.
Okay, go get them. Thanks. Back to you, Doc.
17th Stanley Cup game and the 17th start for Marty Biron, age 30, and splendid for Philadelphia. At the other end, Marc-Andre Fleury has 17 consecutive wins here on this ice at Mellon Arena, dating back over 6 months. Three of those months he was injured with a high ankle sprain.
In the last couple days, there's been a little bit of a bug going around inside the Penguin locker room. Evgeny Malkin, Peter Sikora did not practice yesterday, so they haven't been on the ice since Friday. 2 days since they've been on the ice. Game five here in Pittsburgh.
Jordan Staal, Maxim Talbot, and Tyler Kennedy begin for the Penguins, with Brooks Orpik and Sergei Gonchar on defense against Mike Richards, Scott Hartnell, and Daniel Briere, with Kimmo Tiiminen starting the game on defense and Randy Jones. Kennedy brings it on. Kennedy, the first shot blocked off by Biron. Sent back along for the control of Jordan Staal. Brought back by Briere, carried on by Richards. And Richards a shot, and that one whistled wide and bounced over near Talbot. Tripped up a bit by Daniel Briere, but it's controlled and feathered back to the blue line, out and then in. Time to take a look at the team leaders presented by the United States Marine Corps. Mike Richards of Philadelphia leads his team with 3 goals in this series, and in faceoff percentage, 65. Sidney Crosby leads the entire playoff, 15 assists. Evgeny Malkin, 1 point from the playoff lead in points, 1 behind Sid and Henrik Zetterberg.
Well, Michael Therrien, head coach of the Penguins, had a little bit of a meeting with Sikora and Malkin. Want a little bit more from both those players. Urgency for the Penguins here in game 5.
And Parent saw this develop on for Upshaw. Upshaw able to carry, has Jeff Carter breaking to the net, but Sidney Crosby took it away, gave it up to Carter, but back on near Ryan Whitney. Big defenseman lost it there to Upshaw, quickly whipped on by Crosby, and started back out by Marian Hossa. Hossa gains the line and leads one over, and the toss was wide of Crosby from Chris Letang. He one-handed it to Whitney for a shot, and that ricocheted off Biron. Laid all the way back out to Ryan Whitney. Depth at forward for both of these teams. You look at their lines when they go through the 3-on-2s in the warm-up before the game, and you just think, boy, there are other teams in the league that would just love to have one of these lines on them.
Like the third line for their first line.
Exactly. Up now to Scotty Upshaw, the playoff penalty minute leader at 44. There was a time when it was Dave Schultz. But that was a long time ago, though it was in this arena that he had some of his memorable battles with Bob Battleship Kelly.
This is the area of the ice that the Philadelphia Flyers really like their game in game 4. I talked to assistant coach Joey Mullen of the Flyers, who said in the neutral zone, we were really good in game 4.
And Shave Gel takes you inside the glass. Here's Mike Milbury.
Doc, the players might be heated up, but inside the building, it's much cooler today. The Pittsburgh Penguins recognized they needed to bring the temperature down, so they got 2 huge air conditioners, stuck them outside the building. As one of the employees said to me, when Sid the Kid wants it colder in here, we buy big air conditioners.
Where's the thermostat? We want to warm it up here, Mike.
Building constructed in 1962, should it be Pittsburgh and Detroit in the final, you would have 2 of the older arenas in the league. This is a backhander in front by Briere that's geared away and taken on by Jarkko Ruutu. Lobbed ahead now for Staal. Most impressive in game 4 for Pittsburgh. He put that one into the catching glove of Biron. Time for the competitive edge, sponsored by Edge Shave Gel. And what have we today? 15 straight wins at home, 7-0 in the 2008 playoffs. It was the San Jose Sharks back in late February that defeated the Penguins here in a shootout by a score of 2-1. And that was about the time that Pittsburgh started to put the defensive clamps on that have prevailed to now.
You go back to that month of March there for the San Jose Sharks, when they went 18-0-2 in March.
It's around to George Larocque. The big winger centered one in front, and it deflected off a stick and is corralled and started along, but not out. Larocque walled to the half boards, and a penalty coming up. It'll be against the Flyers. First power play of the game to the Penguins.
It's going to be on Mike Knoebel. So energy coming from the fourth line. Maxime Talbot, who got bumped up in game four with a little bit more speed with Stahl and Kennedy. Out here with LaRocque and Hall. The effort, the continuing of moving the legs by Maxime Talbot, draws the penalty. And there you see the stick in the midsection from Mike Knoebel.
Power play sponsored by Heineken Premium Light. Knoebel the hook. The Penguins overall in the series are 3-for-14 on the power play. That is subpar for them. And over the games in Philadelphia, only 1-for-6. Crosby, a drive, deflected, score! Malone!
Well, the play from Marian Hossa to Sidney Crosby, and it goes off the left skate of Ryan Malone. This looks like this puck is directed in with the left skate. And from our Navy net cam, the shot, pass by Sidney Crosby. No chance for Marty Biron. Goes off the left skate of Malone.
Paul Dvorsky is the referee. Mike Hassenfratz has joined him here for this contest today. But now it is being reviewed. Let's watch this ourselves again.
And the left skate of Ryan Malone going hard to the net. With the presence of mind of Sidney Crosby, that's no distinct kicking motion from what I can tell off the left skate. It looks like it's directed in. Watch Malone, he's in the corner. Never touched his stick, but directed with the skate. That's okay, and the Pittsburgh native gives the Penguins an early 1-0 lead.
I'm sitting right beside Ryan Malone. He had never had a doubt. He thought it was legit all the way.
What else do you notice early down there, Mike? Not sure if he's able to hear us. Meanwhile, I can understand why. If you got the ovation on that goal, flopped on now by Teeminen, and the bouncer came on back. The Let's Go Pens chant reverberates through this arena. Little pass on to Sidney Crosby. Backhander is turned aside by Biron. Dupuis jostles with Prosper. Coming by is Crosby. Nearby to play it is Hossa. Hossa gaining the half boards at least. Lobbed it back on, hoping for Dupuis. It came along to Crosby. Worked on there by Ryan Parent. Crosby tried to get it in front, went down, and the pass is cut and started back out by the Flyers. And so Marc-Andre Fleury out to get it. Lupul in on the forecheck for Philadelphia. He's out there with Jim Dowd right now and Patrick Thorason. Brought back ahead for a toss back in by Evgeny Malkin, 71 in black.
Good finish hit there by Thorason on Malkin.
A weak toss, and so now the Flyers can outman. They've got a 3-on-2 developing. It's across to Kapanen. Looks, fed it back. Darian Hatcher with a shot that deflected off a leg and went wide. Pumped on back to the half board, then pulling away was Kapanen, and then he's sent down to the ice by Ryan Malone, and the puck picked off at center. So was it a faulty decision on that odd man rush to hold up through traffic or not?
I guess once you take that hesitation, Doc, it's probably too late, so you just got to react right away, and if not, you got to just keep going.
Carter, a shot, bounced loose off of Fleury, but came wide, and then it's fed out for a shot by Upshaw, and Fleury got that one, and it's cleared off a stick and back down, but they ruled that it will be an icing touch-up, and the fans don't like that.
Well, Jeff Carter entering the zone. Just takes a quick little shot there, and the puck takes a crazy carom. With Mike Knoebel going hard to the net, pushing back the defense. And Marc-Andre Fleury almost kicked that puck right into his own net. Good job of recovering there by the young goaltender. Number one pick in the entry draft back in 2003.
His rehab from the high ankle sprain took a long time. It began with very light workouts and bicycle and eventually on the ice, but that was a month and a half before he actually got some ice work. and then returned and has just been virtually as flawless as you can be.
Well, he was one of three, right? Talbot had one, Doc an ankle. Crosby had an ankle.
Crosby missed 28 games with his ankle sprain. A couple of segments, but one long one of 21. As this is angled back in now for Hal Gill, the big towering defenseman centered along now for Kennedy to outlap. Brought ahead by Jordan Stahl. Dropped it back off for Kennedy. Here's Kennedy making the drive and then shooting one that ricocheted off Ryan Perrin. Spun back to the boards and it'll have to be gathered in by Rob Scudero. Huntington, Long Island native, a high school product from that school. Laid back in, Mike Komisarek, Christopher Higgins also, NHLers that have come from that area. Brought back ahead now by Richards, able to pull away from one, up the wing, gaining it as Hartnell, and Hartnell dips the shoulder and fed, hoping for Richards, a backhander, is covered by Fleury.
Well, nice little play by Scott Hartnell coming through the middle of the ice, puts it between his legs, gets it up and just tries to throw it in front of the net, slows up perfectly. For Mike Richards, there's Hartnell, he's going to take a look, but it goes off of Brooks Orpik, so it slows up, and it gives Richards an opportunity to just chip the puck towards the net. No rebound given up by Fleury.
Malone's goal came on the power play from Crosby and Hossa at 2:30. This is one cleanly for the shot by Jason Smith. Bounced off the boards in the back of the cage. Dug out now by Hartnell, knocked down by Brooks Orpik. Tries to get back up and play it again. It's given up to Talbot, but not out. Ricocheted right back, Daniel Briere, flipped one, Talbot got it. And Talbot tried to play further and could not, but Hossa comes by. Moves up with Crosby and with Talbot. It slowed at the line and then dumped in for Biroff. Brought back ahead now by Knubel. It is Brooks Orpik, circle to circle across. What are you noticing down there, Mike?
Well, one thing that Michel Therrien is telling his guys is hit the seam when they get in the offensive zone. He thinks there's a gap between the Philly D and their forwards. Try to hit that seam and make it through the into the slot for good opportunities.
A lot of chatter down there?
Yeah, lots of chatter on both sides here, but I don't sense any kind of panic on the side of Philadelphia. They seem to be ready to go right back at it despite the one-goal deficit.
Darian Etcher gave it on now to Upshaw. Backhands one that had to be turned aside by Fleury as it went through a moving screen set up by Carter. Onto the back now. Parrott a shot. And that one went wide. Adam Hall to play that. Swept it around behind and all the way out again.
The Phillies having their opportunities. And we really got good center ice drive. So when the puck is on the wall, that man in the middle of the ice is pushing back the defense for the Penguins.
Tiemannen tangled up with George LaRocque in the goal crease, went down, but it is brought right back as play continues. Fleury didn't stop that one. Upshaw did, pitched it back along, hoping for Carter, and he got it, but just that quickly lost to Malkin and back to center. Another change in line for Philadelphia. Pass is blocked by Hal Gill, then lifted back in, and burrowing in after this one on the forecheck is Daniel Briere. That is fired back around for Gill. Weak toss, though, is cut off. Fed on back now for the shot by Richards. That's booted aside by the defense of Rob Scuderi. So on at center, Richards got it, nearly gave it up, and did to Malone. Follow-up now comes across to Sikora. Return to Malone, and a shot save! Miron! Turnovers at either end, carried on by Richards with Hartnell. Looks across for Briere, the pass flew through him. Jabbed onto the back, drive by Jones, deflected well wide off the glass. And Malone flipped it back out. Sikora shuffled it on, and then Sikora paused a bit with big Darian Hatcher. Malkin and Sikora, the two who have been sidelined briefly by the flu, have come to the bench now in a line change. Don't seem to be showing any ill effects here, as this is brought ahead by Kapanen, chopped away, but right across to Jim Dow. Brick, New Jersey native, tried to work it ahead and couldn't. Jordan Stahl's pass is tipped aside, but then lifted back in. Jarkko Ruutu did that. Chopped on for Stahl, who had wiped out, and it's brought back ahead by Dow. He's got Thorsson moving with him. This is lobbed near the trapezoid and is paddled back, but into trouble by Fleury. Help came from Letang, but trouble there. And then emerging with it is Kennedy to slide a pass across to Jordan Stahl.
Little indecision there by Fleury. Kind of hesitated for a second because that puck was in that no-touch zone, Zach. A good job there by Thorsson to put some pressure on the Penguin goaltender.
You like the pace so far?
It's been pretty good. I think it's been cautious to a certain extent.
Crosby a shot, and that flew up into the mesh. Clock stopped. 11:09 to go. First period. 6-4 Penguins, and one of them in.
Well, there's Kimmo Tiimonen. Hasn't played in a game since game five of the series against the Montreal Canadiens. We're back on May 3rd.
That's a lot of work. A lot of work early. Important work as Dupuis' shot is blocked off. Rebound! Oh, and sliding across to block it. And then tumbling to the ice was Richards.
Tremendous effort there by Sidney Crosby. The explosion to try to get that loose puck. Good defense there by the Flyers. There's a wide open net in behind the line.
Steal by Hossa. Down to the ice of Flyers. He tried to pull his way through, and that was Tiimonen, who's back to his feet. Played on to Crosby. Finessed away by Prospel and shuffled back. Parent connects back across to Tiimonen. Then it's laid ahead for the carry out, but the pass ricocheted off of Crosby. Popped along the boards, and they still battle for it. And then able to pull it away and slide it back in for a shift change was Hossa. Scuderi ahead. Back around to Biron. Played it away from Malone. Near Malkin, back to Malone.
No sector of Biron.
Uh-oh, out in front. Score! Malkin!
Well, this puck is dumped in by Rob Scuderi. He goes and makes the change. Ryan Malone comes in contact with Biron. He loses his stick. Now the puck is shipped in behind. If Evgeny Malkin recognizes that, keeps the puck on the ice now. Biron has his stick. Malkin's not able to attack the side of the net as easy as he does. And then the opportunity off the right hand into the back of the net. But the forecheck of Ryan Malone, the lost stick by Biron. This allows Malkin to jam it from behind, and a 2-0 lead for the Penguins.
No points for Crosby, Hossa, and Malone in game four. They all figured on the first goal in game five, and then Malkin has connected for the ninth time in this series, his third goal. Malone gets the primary and only assist. Whitney, a shot deflected up high and out of play. Past the halfway point of the first period. Penguins have the lead on the Flyers in the elimination game, and they can do it 2-0.
Coach, you can't get a better start than that, right?
Yeah, we need to have a good start. And to make sure we get a good start, I believe we need the right attitude. And I think this thing right now, this is what we're having. We got the right attitude. We keep our game really simple. We try to put a lot of pressure to the goaltender, Martin Biron. He's been phenomenal so far. But, right now, I really like the way that the tempo's on our side.
Very good. Thank you, Coach. Back to you, Doc.
Upshaw, a strong shot out of the glove of Fleury, but brought back on by Crosby. Laid across, and it's dumped back in by Pascal Dupuis.
We've done a whole bunch of Pittsburgh Penguin games, but I have not seen their coach this active, this vocal, in all the games that we've done with him this year.
You can watch some of those active players by checking out the all-new NBCSports.com and NHL.com to expand your hockey experience. Right now and throughout the game, we're streaming two live ISO cams featuring players like Sidney Crosby, Evgeny Malkin, Mike Richards, and other star players on the ice. Available right now at NBCSports.com and NHL.com.
Trying to push all the right buttons for Michael Therrien and the Penguins.
Sikora shot, pad stop, Biron rebound, and he's able to hang on to it.
First goal of the game was directly off of a face-off and set little play here off the face-off by the Penguins. Win the draw, get people to the net. Gonchar to Sikora. And a stop by Biron. No second chance opportunity.
The sing-song chant is Marty as this is brought back ahead by Daniel Briere. Briere swung it off the defenseman around behind. Tripped up on the play, and a penalty will be coming to the Flyers as tumbling down was Fleury. The touch by Biron and the toss of the puck back out to center. But a power play coming up to the Penguins.
Well, we saw how active yesterday Marty Turco was with playing the puck. Marc-Andre Fleury comes out here. Danny Briere makes a little play, gets it in behind, and then Hartnell goes in and unfortunately gets his stick caught up in the backside of Marc-Andre Fleury. He only has one hand on his stick when he does this. Takes the legs out from under Fleury, a little bit of a shot with the leg as well. Referee Mike Hasenfratz with the call.
Heineken Premium Light power play for the Penguins. Kukkonen took his man down, and just getting back up is Hossa. Carried ahead. Malkin has shot, and that ricocheted off of Veron and went up into the mesh. Faceoff will stay back there. It took 12 seconds on the first power play for the Penguins to score.
The Penguins keep having this thought process, Doc and Mike, about if the lanes are there, just get it to the net, then all those small little plays will open up. And if you're a penalty killer, you're going to be in a retreat mode, respecting the shot first. And then if they do that, then those little plays will open up.
This is Hossa turning. Has Crosby swirling. Gave it to the back to Malkin. Dropped back to Hossa. Malkin, a one-time shot, went wide. Rebound, Malone tried to chip it home. And with the help of Jones, Veron was able to shut that off. Played on now to Jim Dowd. And the veteran is able to clear it back all the way down. 8:10 left first period. The first 40 seconds of this power play have been killed off by the Flyers. Coasting on with it now as Malkin rips it back in, and Veron calmly stops and fiddles it on now for Jones. Banked it further, and it went by the sweep of Malkin and back down for Sergei Gonchar. So nearly half killed off now. Turned back along to Ryan Whitney. Lobs one ahead that is carried further. Sidney Crosby brings it on. Forced to the outside by Tiemannin. Dropped back off a leg. Looking for it, Crosby. Got it back from Malkin. Returned it off him in the back of the cage. Ripped back to Crosby. He's got Sikora alone in front. Gave it on to the point now to Whitney. Back to Crosby. Has Sikora. Shot. Went off Parrott. Rebound off the outside of the net from Malkin. And it's clear.
Nice play there by Crosby. Sikora finding that soft little area and a penalty killing for the Flyers.
Malkin able to give it over to Sikora, quickly to Crosby, and Crosby looks over the traffic. Onto the back for the walk by Gonchar. Hands it across to Whitney. Back to Gonchar for the drive. Blocked in front, and it's picked up by Jason Smith and cleared back down. Good screens were set up by the Penguins. A couple got all the way through. Meanwhile, it is brought back ahead, and Whitney rattles it on around for the take by Lassi. Kukkonen cleared it off Sikora, has to try again. This one bounced back for the keep by Letang, but they ruled it had been paid by a high stick. And so with 6 3/4 minutes to go in the first 2-0 Penguins.
Well, if you're going to get to the front of the net, you're doing a couple things. You're going to screen the goaltender in front. There's that pass by Crosby, and Malkin tries to hit that open side to the left of Marty Veron. But if you're going to go to the front of the net, you're going to draw some traffic. You're going to draw people to you. You're going to create a screen in front of the goaltender. And you're going to open up those passing and shooting lanes. If somebody gets to the front of the net, if nobody's there, it's easy to protect and keep people to the outside. But once there's somebody there, Mike, it's hard to defend.
And all in all, a huge sigh of relief from the Philadelphia bench. Going down 3-0 against this Pittsburgh Penguins team would have been just too steep a hill to climb.
Some of those shots got through, but not on net. There were no shots on goal during that power play, so something for the Flyers to build from in the effective penalty kill that time. The bouncer came on now for Prosper, fed one in front that is tipped away from Briere. Might be an odd man rush. It's two against two right now as the Flyers have changed. Adam Hall flips one in front, fought off by Briere, or check that, around in front by Veron. Meanwhile, played away from Briere and towards the corner where Hall moves in and steps into Hatcher. All able to go further, closed off effectively by Joffrey Lupul, and a centering pass attempt fails. So the first 14 minutes have been played. The shots are 9-5 in favor of the Penguins, who lead 2-0 on goals by Malone and Malkin.
Could be an ice in here.
And there is. Passed the exam again, didn't you? 2-0 Pittsburgh here in period number one. The NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC are brought to you by Verizon Wireless. Get NHL highlights at the buzzer, every buzzer. Text your favorite team to 78255 to sign up for NHL mobile video alerts only from Verizon Wireless. Faceoff picked up by Crosby. As Hossa trying to step away from Crosby, right out in front, and he shoved the shot wide. Lobbed ahead for the carry by Jeff Carter. Carter with a shot that's blocked off by Ryan Whitney. Boston University product holds behind and hands on to Chris Letang. Letang's pass skipped back to center, tipped back along again and carried by Knubel, could not finesse through Letang. Hossa able to bring it ahead. Couple of head fakes there. Then crossed up at the corner, but he escaped. Hossa falling and back up to play again. Good persistence by him and by Ryan Parent of the Flyers' defense. Then worked right back along off of Crosby's stick, given a shove from behind by Tiemannin. Along now to Crosby, challenged by Tiemannin again, and it's played to Letang and back down. So it's Kennedy banking it behind for Letang. Another change for the Flyers as they get Jim Dowd's line back out there along with Sammy Kapanen and also Patrick Thoris. Lobbed ahead, but that one is blocked off by Kennedy and kicked on back for Brooks Orpik. Forced back on by Ruutu, but it popped out of play. Back downstairs inside the glass, and Mike.
The really great players go where other people fear to tread. Sidney Crosby is certainly a great player, and he likes to take it to the net as often as possible because that's where you're going to get your chances. This is in tight, very difficult maneuvering for Crosby, and then he takes it directly out front, near miss. Great chance, great try by a great player.
If you're defending Sidney Crosby on that particular play, Vinny Prosper there, you can't be too tight on his back. He is so elusive, and that's a great illustration there of showing everybody of, you know, if you get too tight on his backside, he's just going to spin off you. So you almost just have to keep him there and prevent and keep an arm's length away so he doesn't get to the front of the net like that, the most dangerous area.
Sent down was Smith by Ruutu, and the Roo chant goes up as a feed is in front, and a shot went off of a stick, and it's brought back ahead by Richards. Lead across to Daniel Briere. Shifted from center to the wing last game. Richards off the back of the cage with that shot. Hartnell nearby, played along by the big defenseman Darian Hatcher and laid back out for the grab by Jones. Protects and feeds one that bounced right back over to Ruutu again. Finished born winger, able to lob the bouncer in, and it stopped and then paddled away by Biro. 3:40 left first period. Shots are 10-5 Penguins, and they lead 2-0.
And that's a pretty accurate reflection of the way this game has gone. Pittsburgh's intensity is palpable down here today, Doc.
Well, you were mentioning the coach and how revved up he was. As a coach, do you show a little different persona sometimes and save it for big games like this?
I don't know if you save it for the right time. I don't know if it's a big game or just any other game, but he seems to know. Maybe took a lesson from the Detroit Red Wings yesterday, who are a little bit lackadaisical or uptight, as Mike Babcock called them. He's not going to let his team just throw this one in. They're intense from start to finish, from first line to fourth.
Malone trickled it in. Good hit by Talbot on Umberger. Malone and Umberger, the two Pittsburgh products, born and raised here, played their hockey here. Still battling 12 and 20 in the black and white. Played along now by Malone, sealed up by Umberger, taken along by Hatcher, given a good shoulder there by Ruutu. Or check that, LaRocque, and now LaRocque is staring at Hatcher. And they shove at one another. Nothing much has happened just yet. And the pass ricocheted back in. Tiemannin goes back for that, and an icing touch-up may bring about an olive branch.
Well, good hard work.
Good hard work and good discipline by George LaRocque. Maybe listen to Sidney Crosby. You said we got to play whistle to whistle. None of this extracurricular stuff. There's no question he's totally unafraid. Making Scott Hartnell know sure he'll be around for the next shift, but he's got to stay within the rules.
Well, the battle and the hard work down low, LaRocque and Hatcher having words up ice. And really, for the Penguins, no sense and no need to really give any momentum to the Flyers here. LaRocque challenging Hatcher, trying to change the tide of the game if you're the Flyers, being down by 2 goals. But LaRocque, good composure, playing whistle to whistle, as you mentioned, Mike. Saw a lot of that chatter back in game 4 in Philadelphia.
It is back for a shot by Tiemannin that went off the stick of Talbot, well wide. Picked up though by Briere, a little pass in front, ricocheted off skates, but there'll be a penalty coming up and it'll be against Pittsburgh. And so the Flyers will get their first power play chance of the day.
Yeah, off a faceoff win by the Flyers. Penguins aren't able to make a change because they ice the puck at even strength. So John Stevens, the head coach of the Flyers, comes back with the Richards, Carter, Hartnell line. Ryan Whitney, just at the last second there, Breer was able to get some body position on him and got the stick around the midsection of the arm, and referee Paul Dvorsky with the call.
Kind of weak, and Mike Therrien wants that standard to be upheld for both teams right now, Doc.
Interesting that you would have that first one, and that's the one that you will yell about because you want to make the impression for the next one and the next one after that.
consistency. If you get the stick parallel and it comes on a guy's waist or his arm, the referees are instructed to call the penalty. That's exactly what happened. I thought it was a right call.
Rushed along by Tiemannin and carried on back on this power play. Mike Richards will be the trigger puller a lot of times back at the point, 18 and White. It's Hartnell's pass, cut, finesse neatly, and lobbed back out again by Jordan Staal.
You're a penalty killer. You're coming back into your zone, especially you're the leap forward. You come back to the middle of the ice. Everything's got to come through the middle of the ice. Great positioning there by Jordan Staal.
The best player for the Penguins in the losing cause in Game 4 in Philadelphia the day after he attended his grandfather's funeral. The entire Staal family, condolences to them. Meanwhile, this is turned back along and worked back in close traffic away from Letang. Half court, fed back by Lupul, taken by Tiemannin and fed back to him. Lupul able to avoid the sweep of Kukui, and a shot went off the leg of Gonchuk. Nearing the halfway point of the power play, nearing the last 80 seconds of the period. Rier gave it across, Tiemannin touched it on further. Grabbed off there by Mike Richards. Alternate captain laid one in front. The tacked out of the air by Dupuis. Nudged on back, and it'll be kept by Briere again. Daniel Briere in the last 50 of this power play now. Watched tightly by Dupuis. It's laid on back to Tiemannin again. Lifted back over for Richards. Richards spun it off the boards. Hartnell played it there. Watched by Brooks Orpik. Knocked down by Orpik. Kicked back along. And it is lifted, but right into Richards. Another try by Talbot. This one careened, but not out. Tiemannin keeps the pressure on. They can't make a change. Rolled around behind through Hartnell. Taken by Briere, fed in front. Played by Dupuis. And he's able to backhand it off a glove and out. They get the fire wagon change they wanted with 15 left on the power play. Tiemannin has been out there the whole time. Lugs it ahead now and shakes it back in off the paddle stick of Clurie. Jammed around behind off of Umberger. Umberger trying again and Hal Gill prevailed. Tiemannin has to play at center. Made the safe play back to his goalie. Penalty box is empty. Biron behind had to be very careful to stay inside the trapezoid.
Some good control on the Flyers power play there, but nothing to show for it.
They are standing in the last 2 seconds. Out of play, but the period ended. 15 shots, two-thirds of them by Pittsburgh, and they got both gold. 2-0 Penguins at the end of one, and coming up on the Dodge Journal intermission report, Bob Neumeier and Mike Milbury discuss yesterday's Dallas win in Detroit, and we'll hear from Mike Modano, plus first period analysis and Marc-Andre Fleury. That's on the Dodge Journey Intermission Report right after these messages. The NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC are brought to you by Dockers Work Weekend Dress Golf. By the Ridgeline from Honda, strength meets intelligence. By the people who make one-touch products, more power to you. And by ADT, America's number one security provider. You're watching the NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC Sports, presented by Ed Shave Gel. Mike Milbury.
Doc, only 5 shots on goal for the Philadelphia Flyers in the first period. This sets up as a great opportunity to start the second on the power play. They need one here badly.
Hartnell will work up front. Richards will probably take a point. Briere will hope for that quick pass across in the stash in that worked so well in the Montreal series. Hartnell will be the big presence. Lupul is the other forward to join them. The pass comes on to Lupul. Fires, and that one turned aside and then trickled on back for Richards. Plays it back safely to Briere. Hands it on now for Tiemannin. Tiemannin across to Richards again. Draws a man toward him. Gives on across now for a play to be made by Carter, or check that Lupul. Little trouble for him there as he was watched by Gonchar. Then back into Briere. Briere fed it back. Tiemannin one-timer. Blocked right back out again by Fleury. Tiemannin again. Hands back on to Richards. Tiemannin with a shot. That one went wide. Briere chipped it off the outside of the cage. Worked back off Briere's stick. Worked by Jordan Staal. Kept alive though by the Flyers and worked on by Briere. Briere turning with it now. Forced to the corner by Stahl's long reach. Fed it on back, but off of Richards to center.
Yeah, unfortunately couldn't make a direct pass there. Just kind of came across the pass and it jammed. Richards wasn't able to keep it in.
Another bouncer comes back out and is played just through Jordan Staal and offside against Philadelphia. All right, let's go back to that penalty at the end of the period.
Yeah, maybe the follow-through here of Ryan Malone on the hit on Jeff Carter. Watch his stick as he follows through. Maybe right there, the clip of the stick right in front of the referee. So the right call being made by referee Mike Hassenfrotz. The follow-through on the stick. You have to be in control of your stick. The right call made there by Mike Hassenfrotz.
Jones drummed it back in. Slowed, but not stopped by Fleury. Though guided around there, away from Dupuis. Kept by Randy Jones again. Skipped one off the stick of Carter. Second wave is out there on the Flyer power play. Umberger hands it back to Carter. At the front of the net is Mike Knuble of Philadelphia. Jostled there and shoved a bit by Big Hal Gill. Umberger gave it back, and he and Carter change places now. 18 left on the power play. Fed back to Umberger once more. In front, but right on the stick of Maxim Talbot. Brings it ahead and gives on to Dupuis in a two-on-two with Kapanen back. And he made a good job defending on Talbot there to keep that from being a good chance on Biron. But penalty time's up.
Awfully close to a penalty there on Tapp, and he got that stick parallel. And I don't think Talbot was able to get the stick on it, Doc, because his hands were tied up. Wasn't able to extend away from his body.
And Mike Therrien certainly agrees with Edzo. He thought it was a penalty all the way.
Brought back ahead now by Crosby, and Crosby is able to scoot right in by, but to the corner he had to get control. Crosby turning again, backhander is blocked down. Coming across now is Hossa. Hossa gave it back to Ryan Whitney. Wrister is fought off by Biron. Half court, Crosby gave it on to Malone. Shoved back for Hossa. Hossa ended the Rangers series in game five with an overtime winner. One of the advantages the Penguins have had, not having to play many games and having to play only one overtime game. And that one wasn't very long. Brought back ahead by Dowd and given on to Mike Knuble, could not get by. Michael Therrien, what is the least appreciated thing about your team? This was as the playoffs started. He said, people don't understand how good we are on our defense. Our six guys have been good so far, and so has Fleury. He's faced only six shots.
Pretty simple back there with the way that they play and they defend.
There it comes to Orpik.
Just when you have forwards like they have, just get it up to the forwards and let them do all the work. They've got high-skilled guys offensively with Gonchar and Whitney back there. The other four guys, pretty simple, just move it out of the zone and play good defense.
Richards across. Friera shot patched up. Rebound, another stop made by Fleury. Bang, bang, play, and he got them both. Ruutu trying to plow his way through. That one skipped on for Peter Sikora.
Great saves by Fleury.
And the chant is Fleury, Fleury. 4 minutes played in the second period as of now. No change in the score from that power play that began the period. The glove down by Hal Gill. 6'7", 250 pounds. Laid that one ahead that went off of Prospel. And Prospel is able to rescue him. Pass is given up, though, to Kennedy. Tried to step by. Jordan Staal was there running a little interference. Skip back on, and it's hooked out to center where Gill comes up with it and lays it back in. Darian Hatcher flips it ahead. Umberger could not get by. Safe play off the back of the cage. It's brushed along by Gill. But unable to shift to offense, the Penguins, and an offside pass to Umberger.
Well, just getting the puck to net, forcing Marc-Andre Fleury to make a stop, and then getting people to the net. Richards to Briere, watch the left pad. There's the save, and then Hartnell with a great chance. And then Darian Hatcher comes in looking for an opportunity, but good defensive play there by Peter Sikora. Again, just get it to the net, sticks on the ice. And you give up quality opportunities, you need your goaltender to come up large. And that's exactly what Marc-Andre Fleury did on that last opportunity for the Flyers.
The World Championships of Hockey have been going on up in Quebec and in Halifax for the last couple of weeks. A lot of NHL players have been there. Russia has won the gold medal game in overtime over Team Canada, 5-4. And the scoring play, guys, you'll recognize. Ilya Kovalchuk, the goal. Alexander Ovechkin, the primary assist. And Sergei Fedorov, the secondary. Long toss ahead went off of Scotty Upshall and deflected out of play. Let's take a look at the Dockers' four impact players in this series so far and how they've done. Crosby with 2 and 4. Malkin with 3 goals, 2 assists. Fleury, 3 and 1. And Richards with 3 goals and 15 hits, 8 blocked shots, sacrificial player all the way.
Crosby, an assist on the Malone goal, and Malkin with the second one, the 2-0 lead.
Vote for the Impact player in each series at impact.nbcsports.com for a chance to win $500 in Dockers gear.
A little bit of line changing going down for the Penguins. Had Maxime Talbot on that last line with Stahl and Kenny, the way they finished game four. Now you have Malkin out here with Malone and LaRocque on the right side.
Go to nhl.com/edge to read great articles on the history of NHL players and their playoff beards. You can also view historical and current photo galleries of players and their beards. It's all at nhl.com/edge. I don't blame Mike Modano for shaving it off. I would think by this time of year in hot Dallas, and it was in the 80s down there, that'd be miserable.
Right, down 3-0. What else you got to lose? It's worked so far, 2-for-2 with the clean-shaven Mike Modano.
Up played along the boards by George LaRocque. Got it back to Whitney for a shot that's well wide. Whacked at by Upshaw, and that one popped loose, but it's still up for grabs, and Malkin has it. Took the hit. Got some help from LaRocque. Back on to Malkin. Run off. LaRocque able to come up with that. Big George around behind is walled there by Carter. Reaching in, trying to poke it free. Got it onto Malone. Off to LaRocque. And then it's fed along, but right to Whitney. Whitney holds and swings it across. Letang dealt it further. Walked right back on and shaken across by Dupuis. Chipped back on now by Whitney. And then lifted on out to center. And laid back in. And LaRocque and Malkin come to the bench for a change in lines. Big physical winger, appreciated greatly here by the Mellon Arena crowd.
End of that first period there, we showed him and Darren Hatcher coming up ice. Hatcher, a guy that is on the body, likes to get the hands up around the face, and you know that LaRocque's got the back of all his teammates out on the ice. Just talking to Hatcher, doing his job.
Nudged on now to Jordan Stahl. Dug out by Kennedy. Not much room to turn, and it's given over to Sammy Kapanen. Pass came up the wing for the lob back in by Jim Dowd, and way out to get it, Fleury. I guess he's okay with that. Played along to the corner, dangerously close to the trapezoid. Difficult call to make, but it's played back along by Hal Gill.
Must be contagious. Watch a Marty Turco yesterday in Detroit.
They seem to have a presence of knowing how to do it without getting the minor penalty call that would come if you were in that pie slice minute. But here is Hatcher turning around behind, took a swat from Rutu. 7 minutes elapsed, time gone in the second period, and Fleury covers this one. 12:49 left. Shots are 11-8. 3 for Philly, 1 for Pittsburgh so far in the second.
Doc, Eddie, first period for Pittsburgh Penguins. Lots of energy. They got what they needed, a 2-goal lead. Now it's up to the Philadelphia Flyers to make a statement. They are starting to run out of time.
7-11 gone here in the second period of an elimination game for the Penguins against Philadelphia. If they can pull it off. The Flyers were sticky to earn that first win of the series back in Philadelphia 2 days ago. That one is fed along but not out because of the bulk of Adam Hall, 28 in black, in the way. Worked on by Parent, grabbed off though by Gonchar, and Gonchar speeds it across now for Brooks Orpik. Orpik with the long toss, and that caromed on back now to Ryan Parent. Parent lobbed it along, and it went off the glove of Jordan Stahl. Stahl comes in, an impressive faceoff man in this series. Mike Richards has been the most prominent Philadelphia Flyer in getting faceoffs, 67%. But Stahl's percentage has been very strong too, though not as big as has Richards. Fed back across now for Lassi Kukkonen. Pass went off a Pittsburgh stick and is protected by Gonchar. Squibby pass off the boards, took a crazy bounce, right back over and denied away from Richards by the work of Crosby. Taken on by Talbot. Pass was away from Hossa. Brought on by Crosby. Sent by Hossa to Crosby again to Hossa. Score!
Well, Doc, you made mention of it. Sidney Crosby working at both ends of the ice. He comes back. He lifts up the stick of Mike Richards. His job isn't done. Now he jumps into play. Maxime Talbot with a little play to Hossa. Doesn't follow through. And then Crosby. Quick little pass. No hesitation. A soft goal given up by Marty Biron on the short side. But if Crosby is cheating offensively, Doc, the Flyers have something going down low.
Crosby and Talbot, the assist on Hossa's ninth. And in this series, his fourth. Malkin, a falling shot that went to the glass. Taken on now by Malone. And then Scuderi. The blast off the boards, hoping for Malone, and eventually got him. Ryan Malone, whose father Greg played for this team. Got it on to Malkin. Around in front, and a shot held off, and then covered by the glove of Biron.
Umberger and Malkin, and then Hal Gill comes in to try to get in between his teammate and R.J. Umberger.
Right now, guys, the Flyers need something. I don't know if this is exactly it, but they got to get themselves psychologically back into this game.
Well, Evgeny Malkin had a good rush right before this here, and he uses that big body to protect the puck, get it to the front of the net. Umberger with a little bit of hold, Malkin with a little bit of a shot. It's been like this all series long for the most part, especially in the two games in Philadelphia. Evgeny Malkin, a target, of course, not only because he's one of the top players for the Penguins, but he has the puck all the time when he's out on the ice. Either got to be hit. You got to be a guy that hits or be hit when you're involved in the center of the action. Malkin's certainly been one of those guys. It's been a target of the Flyers all series long.
Be interesting to see how the penalties sort out here. Hal Gill is standing in the penalty box for Pittsburgh. Umberger is in the box for Philadelphia, but we don't know if there are any more. The one outstanding penalty on the board right now is that of Malkin's, a minor. So it may very well be a Philadelphia power play, and it looks as though it is. TGI Fridays will bring you this power play to John Stephens' team, the Philadelphia Flyers.
Well, this is a must, Doc, and Mike, this is a must for the Philadelphia Flyers. Power play almost halfway gone. Is John Stephens talking to Vinny Prospo? Those two guys played together in the American Hockey League back in 1996, the first year of the Phantoms, the minor league affiliate for the Flyers in Philadelphia. This is a must for the Flyers. They got to get on the board here.
And the Penguins have been, penalty killing has been just excellent. Lots of pressure, forcing all the way down, not giving any point chance to Kimmo Tiivanen, and trying to keep it away from their go-to guy at the point.
Third power play for the Flyers, and Jordan Staal walked ahead with it, got tripped up, and that will take care of that. Tiivanen to the box. 6 seconds, and then four against four.
Well, Jordan Staal wasn't even supposed to take this faceoff. Adam Hall got thrown out of the original faceoff here, but Staal heads up play, so smart, goes to the net. He had something going there. The Flyers anticipated him to try to win that faceoff back, but he chipped it ahead himself, drew the penalty. Outstanding job there. A smart, smart play by Jordan Staal. And for many years, the Pittsburgh Penguins did not have strength in the middle at the center ice position. Crosby came, Malkin came, now Staal came. Three premier centermen, and Staal can do it all for both ends of the ring.
All first-round draft choices for Pittsburgh, and a lot of impressive numbers for Jordan Staal, but one is his age, 19. Brought on now by Hossa. Wanted to shoot, did not. Four against four here, remember. Hossa trying to get by. That one nicely knifed away, but by the high stick of Randy Jones. And so again, play halted.
Mike, what's the feel down there at ice level?
Well, that's just a killer. They're looking to go on the power play and take it to Pittsburgh, maybe get back in this game. And all of a sudden, it just goes poof. It was very quiet on the Philadelphia bench.
Understandably so. Down 3-1 in the series and having some points where they had a surge. They were down 2-0 after one. Power play early, didn't get anything on it. They've had one shot on their three power plays, and we'll caution that was only a 6-second third power play, but only allowed one shot on goal. One to the point. Brooks Orpik with it there. Driven into the catching glove of Biron by Gonchar.
Well, the Flyers got to get their defensemen involved on this four-on-four. Try to create some offense in this even man situation.
Stahl won it. Taken along by Parent. Worked on by Kukkonen. Back up the boards. It is held and worked deliberately back by Richards to give on to Lassi Kukkonen again. Headman passes on to Briere. Briere roughed up a bit by Brooks Orpik. One of the leading hitters in the league in the regular season and the leader for Pittsburgh in these playoffs. Carried back out by Orpik. Boston College product got it ahead, gave to Malone, and the shot was turned aside by Biron.
I think Orpik might even got a piece of that, Doc, on the redirect. Good stop there by Biron.
And a pass is on the money for Briere, and the big drive is off Orpik and up into the mesh. Four aside for another three quarters of a minute here, with the Penguins ahead 3-0.
It's a pretty steep hill, Coach. When do you let the horses out of the barn here and take some chances?
Well, I just like to see us have a little more composure with the puck. We've got opportunities to get going with it. We're just giving it back to them. And the other thing I'd like to see is get more pucks in the net.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, Doc.
John Stevens and Michael Therrien have coached against one another for today, the 52nd time. Goes back to American Hockey League days. They even played against one another. You were talking about John's earlier career with the Phantoms when John was a rookie in Hershey. That was where Philadelphia put its draft pick. And Michael Therrien was a defenseman for the Baltimore Skipjacks. A team of memory now in the American Hockey League, but that was some time ago. So longtime competitors. Both of these men have coached teams that were 30th overall in a 30-team league and have them in the conference final. And all of that within a handful of years. Long toss ahead. Karen back down and into the trapezoid to force it along as Fleury. And then outletted by Rob Scuderi to be brought back on by Dupuis. A brief power play coming. Letang's shot went to the corner in 3 seconds. Right now Malkin is out of the box. The power play is 6 seconds long. It is Dupuis with Malkin storming toward the net. Played back along by Talbot. Given on to Dupuis. Handed to Malkin. And Malkin just pulls around from the outside. Feeds it back to Ryan Whitney. Full strength. Drive by Malkin. Shrugged away as it ricocheted back in near Biron. Malkin again fakes the drive and pirouettes away from Carter. Right back into traffic. Tripped up. Penalty call. Jeff Carter to the box. Another power play for the Penguins.
Well, Kenny Malkin, fresh from sitting 2 minutes in the box, stays on the outside. I don't know if the Flyers realized that they were back to even strength.
I don't think they did, Edzo. They were very, very passive, just looking like they were in a box formation, and Malkin had plenty of time to handle the puck.
Well, that's where the guy's on the ice. The guy that's coming out, that was teaming, it's got to yell, even, even, we're even. And then you could get into the five-on-five setup, but a good job there by Malkin to draw that penalty.
Power play sponsored by TGI Fridays. We'll have Crosby in to take the draw against Mike Richards. Malone and Hossa, the wingers. Gonchar and Malkin, the point men. Lots of potential there as it's held by Sidney Crosby. Given back on for Hossa. Battling at the front is Malone. A shot by Gonchar. Score!
Hossa, quick little wrist shot, and Ryan Malone with that body position in front of the net. A simple play, not a big slap shot, just get it to the net. Wrist it to the net, and great hand-eye coordination by Ryan Malone off of Marty Biron in behind. No hesitation by Sergei Gonchar.
And there's Sidney Crosby, right where he should be, in front of the net.
Gonchar, the primary assist on Malone's second of the day. Another power play goal for the Penguins. That's Malone's third power play goal of the playoffs and overall his sixth. As ahead now comes Peter Sikora. Malone fed it across. It is a different kind of Sharks, not the San Jose kind in the black uniforms right now, as you can just see them warming to the task of distancing themselves from these Flyers so that they can think about the final. Long toss is carried back on now. Vinny Crosville trying to change their mind, put some doubt in. Crosville, the backhander that is held by Fleury between the pads. It had a little bit of sneak going to it.
Well, Vinny Crosville just getting to the net. You heard John Stevens tell Mike downstairs, and they heard go back to the goal. Giving credit to Sidney Crosby with the goal, but it doesn't look like he touched it.
You could hear a tick down here.
Yeah,
I didn't know
that was Ryan Malone's stick that tipped it the first time. Now, maybe it was a double deflection. Looked like Malone to me. As Peter Sikora is going off the ice to the Penguin dressing room. He's one of the Penguins that has been under the weather the last couple days. But nonetheless, it's the fourth goal of the game. Credited to Crosby right now.
Malone and Gonchar with the assist as it stands now. And they are very concise about reviewing things here in the upper tier in Pittsburgh. So there may be a change of that if they see the video that we did between periods. But for now, that's how it is. So we always write these in pencil, don't we? It's like the New York Times crossword. You don't do it with pen unless you're really confident. Way back across now to Whitney. Pretty good pound back there as you saw Kennedy hit the glass. Meanwhile, this is brought ahead now by Stahl. Held off enough so that Thorason could go back for the Flyers. Aaron Hatcher takes it here with under 7 minutes to go in the second period. Letang works it along. Chipped back further onto Dupuy. Very valuable, serviceable winger for these Pittsburgh Penguins. Defensively oriented, too, is number 9 in the black. Longtime Minnesota Wild player sees this in ahead that is cut off now by Knubel, taken by Malone, handed across to Hossa with Dupuy breaking to the net. Hossa to the outside to Dupuy, and his shot went off Jason Smith. Played back along for Hossa to take it. Speared by Smith, and he stays down. And the puck came back to center, and this is a break now for Upshaw. Upshaw moving in, and it's denied from behind. Dupuy just now going over the boards after having been shaken up. One of the better Flyer opportunities of the day just a moment ago.
Yeah, the puck was rolling on Upshaw. Outstanding job there by Rob Scuderi to come back, not take a penalty, getting some help from the backside as well.
Under 6 minutes to go. Let's go Pens is the chant again. Played along by Biron to Ryan Perrin. Whether it's a big hit or something, the Flyers need that energy rejuvenated again. It's been taken from them here in the second as they're down by 4.
And there's no let up here on the Pittsburgh bench, Doc. And so they're very focused, very alert, very verbal. Everybody's staying right into this thing.
Tipped across and going to get it is Tiemannin.
But we've seen it. No lead is safe. You get one, all of a sudden you get another one, you get a power play, and you're back in this hockey game.
Orpik sent down from behind after Kukkonen's shot was into his body. Played by Talbot, could not finesse through. Keeps working though and chipped that one behind. That is read by Mike Richards. Little over 5 minutes to go in the second period of this. Carried back on by Richards. Richards to the outside. Flipped one that's deflected wide. Oh, and then slumped at the front of the net was Umberger. And doing that was Orpik. Another shot and that one patted away by Fleury. Flyers might be getting a surge here. Another big hit that came into Hartnell and comes all the way back now for Jones. Jones' pass is flagged down. Unable to get to it, though, is Crosby. Brought on now by Crosville and his shot wide. Crosville able to turn. Gonchar watching him. Feathered it back for a shot that deflected up into the mesh. Ruutu face-to-face with Jones. Play halted. Penguins by 4. Verizon Wireless Sounds of the Game with number 25, Maxime Talbot.
Good job, good job. Elboyas, Elboyas. You better have a good job. I like the way you play, bud.
Text your favorite team to 7825 to get NHL mobile video alerts only from Verizon Wireless. Sidney Crosby in on this faceoff along with Prospel. And it came loose near Umberger. And it is Malone who does get credit for the fourth Pittsburgh goal rather than Crosby.
Way to eat those carrots, Doc.
Attaway. Well, you caught it first. You don't wear contacts just to see your glasses like I do. Brought back ahead by Umberger, and that swept away from him, tucked on by Dupuis, and then lifted back in once more, and around to get it is Robin Guderi.
That's what you want to see in a four-goal lead. You want to see Crosby, your best player and your captain, doing the back-checking.
And it is Dupuis bringing this ahead, run into, but following up is Gill. And it's just squibbed back in the last 3:45 of the second.
One thing that's really noticeable for the Penguins is that that's good support with the puck carrier. Never isolated one-on-one, one-on-twos. Always two-on-ones, three-on-twos. Saved there by Marty Biron. It was a 2-0 lead midway through the second period, and a key save at the key time for Marc-Andre Fleury. There's a shot by Danny Briere, and then the second opportunity by Scott Hartnell. 2-0 game, Flyers with a great chance. Fleury doesn't make that save. It's a 2-1 game, a little belief, a little momentum for the Flyers, but key save at the key time by Marc-Andre Fleury.
That one off a glass support. You know, Bob and Mike were talking before the game about the validation that has come to Marty Turco. Just getting his team in the playoffs, but maybe not getting by the first round, and his team wasn't either. But now, arriving in the third and performing wonderfully for the Dallas Stars. And the same might be said of Fleury. Didn't have the chance to play in the playoffs initially. Was in Wilkes-Barre Scranton. Did not have a very good playoff record there. Then last year played in 5 games against Ottawa, and his team was eliminated in 5. Then this year, an altogether different story and an altogether different team. As Thorsson got it across, and the shot is blocked away by Fleury. A blast by Mike Knubel, and it takes a Pittsburgh bounce right across now for the carry by Ryan Whitney.
We're talking about Marty Turco. To me, Doc, I mean, he was sensational last year against the Vancouver Canucks. I think Marty Turco proved to a lot of people last year. Sure, there were still some doubts whether or not he could be the guy, but he's played outstanding for Dave Tippett. Them being down 3-0, Turco really good in games 4 and 5, giving his team an opportunity and, again, experience and going through the times for a guy like Marc-Andre Fleury. Playing in the playoffs.
Yeah, good point. Offside is called. We want to take a look at how our United States Marine Corps team leaders are performing in this game today. Mike Richards has one hit, 13 minutes of ice time, no points. His team has not collected anything in that regard either. 2 assists and a shot for Sidney Crosby. Malkin with a goal on 2 shots himself. And Marty Turco had the lowest goals against average of anybody in the playoffs last year. And that was one of the stats that as you look up and you get to the final series between Anaheim and Ottawa, you see, oh, gee, there he is again. And I'd forgotten about him because his team was out, but those numbers still stood strongly for the Dallas Stars. Team defense wins. And that's what has helped the Stars in their 2 wins and has helped the Penguins in their 3 going on 4. Under a 2-goal-a-game average defensively for Pittsburgh coming into today. And a big goose egg on the side of the Flyers board as one went through a screen and right in on goal for Fleury to block with the pad. Pokes right back along, and Crosby wanted to nudge it further. Without a stick, now he regains that as it is lifted back in by Hatcher. So it is Whitney just waiting behind for Crosby to make the sweep. Crosby tucked it ahead. Dupuis played it back in. The final 80 seconds of the second period. Flying ahead now is Joffrey Lupul trying to get through the quicksand at center ice, and the play has slowed down enough for an offside. Let's take a look at the play of Evgeny Malkin in the Hanes comfort zone. Pretty strong around the net. And as Edzo mentioned earlier, he has been a target here, but he tucked one in. That was the second of 4 Penguins goals. That's our Hanes comfort zone. Jeff Carter on this faceoff that is won by the Penguins and given over to Brooks Orpik. So many of the players on both of these teams have played in the Junior Championships of Canada, the Memorial Cup, and that is going on now in Kitchener, Ontario. A walkout in front, a shot by Stahl, and a backhander, he scores! 5-0.
this is a killer for the Pittsburgh Penguins to put this one in with just about a minute to go in a period. Good forecheck. We talked about it, Edzo. The puck support, attack the net, and a good chip-in goal to make it 5-0. Philadelphia needs a touchdown to come back in this one.
Jordan Staal's backhander finds its way through. And for Staal, who came off a two-goal performance in a losing cause of Game 4, that's his fourth goal of this series. Navy net cam, and you see what the goal judge behind the net. They're still here in Pittsburgh. They let them stand behind the cage and turn the light on. And that helps all of us because they can be much quicker with it than from way up top. Here's Timonen. Given across now for a shot by Richards that came back to him. Richards around behind and fell down and turns to the referee looking for some help. The goal stick left. That is regained now by Fleury. And the play comes back near Brooks-Orpik. 20 to go in the second. Beer on out to hustle that on now for Jason Smith as they are making a change in lines for one last shift, the Penguins are. Brought on by Thorason, gives to Jim Dowd, and Dowd threw one that ricocheted around and in! And it is ruled no goal. A centering toss by Jim Dowd went into the cage. They will probably examine this one up top to see if there's any reason that this should be overruled, but it is ruled no goal. Boy, I could not tell from that.
It looked like a pretty good goal to me. They crashed in it. It looked like it went off a leg, Doc, but I'd have to take a different look at it. They certainly will get it upstairs.
Was this kicked in? Take a look. Distinct kicking motion is one thing that has to happen. Let's look one more time here at the two players at the front of the net. And by then, it is up on the arm of Fleury and directed in, it looks as though, by Thorason. But we'll get more time to deal with that in the intermission. It goes as no goal. Play resumes, so it sticks. 5-0. The Penguins by a fistful at the end of two. Heineken Premium Light Intermission Report. Bob and Mike analyze the second. Eddie Olczyk will join Mike as they tell us what the coaches should be telling their team. Mike's playoff hat trick coming up on the Heineken Premium Light Intermission Report right after these messages. Third period about to begin here in Pittsburgh at Mellon Arena, where the Penguins have a lead in the contest 5-0. It looked as though Philadelphia had scored latter part of the period. The puck certainly crossed the line, but the official ruling is that one of the Flyer players prevented the Penguin goaltender from making the save. It looked as though it was Thorason jostling into Fleury, and the ruling was that prevented him from making a play on the puck, and so for that reason, it was disallowed. And that is not a reviewable. That is just a referee's call that was made. But we wanted to get the details for you and have it now as the third period about to start. Philadelphia Flyers in their 99th game of meaning this year, wanting it to not be the last one, but it's against very tall odds against a team that has been so strong defensively in Pittsburgh. Marc-Andre Fleury played it ahead. Hartnell turnaround shot saved by Fleury. Sent aside by the defense and taken back on by Kennedy. Laid back on for Jordan Staal. Banked it right back in and around it swirled to Biron. Whipped it away with a big goal stick and up the boards it comes back to Brooks-Orpik. And then Sergei Gonchar. Malone with two, Hossa, Staal, and Malkin with goals for the Penguins this afternoon. Played on by Staal, but then lost. At one point, we were mentioning the Canadian Junior Championship. In addition to the World Championships going on, the Memorial Cup involves the Spokane Washington Chiefs, Kitchener Rangers, Belleville Bulls, and Gatineau Olympiques. And it's taking place in Kitchener. It is the junior supremacy of Canada. But there are American franchises in Canadian junior hockey, and one of them, Spokane, has gotten there. This is brought back on near Hossa, but flipped back on for Knubel to nudge across. I think Darian Hatcher played it along to Jones. And across for Knubel, taken right away by Pascal Dupuis. Angled back by Jones, but out of play into the Penguins' bench. Well, the Stanley Cup Final is coming up on NBC, presented by Edge Shave Gel. And we have to be, a little bit vague about this. It is an exciting, thrilling time of year. But in terms of the exact days, it's not known just yet. Coming soon on a TV in front of you at 8 Eastern someday on NBC. And we hope you'll look forward to that as much as we will.
Big hit there by Ryan Malone on Ryan Parent.
Brought back ahead by Prosper. The words of wisdom were pretty impressive by both of you talking about your teams. And I think what Mike was saying is probably what Michelle Therrien was also saying. Michael, down talking to his team, was probably saying, just do what you're doing, but don't step out of any kind of character to do anything differently.
Yeah, no hope plays if you're the Pittsburgh Penguins. Just keep the puck moving ahead. Red line and in if you don't have a play. The Flyers, I talked to assistant coach Joey Mullen on the way upstairs, and he said, we need more shots. We need to create more. And the composure was the word that John Stevens used with Mike down at ice level in that second period. Composure with the puck, and then if you're able to do that, then you're able to make the right play and know where the danger parts are on the ice.
This is Ruutu bringing it ahead, and that off his stick, and then picked up and carried on and laid back in by Staal. George Laroque boomed off the puck by Smith, and then it's taken along by Jordan Staal again, dragging into traffic. Laroque reached in, couldn't come up with it. Timo Timonen played 15 minutes in the first two periods out of the 40. So about the same number of minutes and seconds, about 7.5 in each of the two periods for him.
And Doc Edsel continuing to be amazed by how much Mike Therrien keeps talking to his players on the ice. He's as into it as anybody on the bench. Won't let up, keeps talking about puck support, shooting the puck, getting it at the net.
One of his players from Wilkes-Barre Scranton, Ryan Whitney, flipped that one back out. Racing in is another one that he coached there, Maxim Talbot. Taking this is Kennedy. Malone, a shot looking for the hat trick, but that's stopped by Biron. Nudge back on now for Hartnell. Jammed it across, but it's turned back over in that neutral zone where the Penguins have been so sticky.
Yeah, it's tough to make plays while you're standing still there. Hartnell trying to make a play standing still.
Malone moved off by Hatcher, but keeps working. Fed to Talbot, and the shot is deflected wide. Well wide by Randy Jones.
Boy, Biron was going in behind the net. He thought the puck was going to go around. He left his net, and puck never made it there. And then Talbot, with that good opportunity, got knocked down. Trying to cheat a little bit, Biron, from his goaltending crease.
Maxim Talbot will probably be remembered in this, what appears to be a Penguins rush to the final, as the fourth centerman. Oh, what a goal that time by Hossa. Breaking to the net was Dupuis, and he may have gotten a piece of it. As excited as he is, I think so. But let's see. Is it 9?
I think so, Doc. As you mentioned, the play of the Penguins through the neutral zone. Dupuis moves it, and it pushes back the defense. Simple little play. A wrist shot takes a funny carom. But Dupuis looks. He gets to the net and backskates, actually. And then it goes off, it seems like, the right hip or the right leg of Pascal Dupuis. The domination through the neutral zone here in game 5. Penguins up by 6.
They have credited to Hossa. And we mentioned that they are very, very precise about making sure these goals are awarded properly. And they go initially by the information that is phoned up to them from ice level. And then they examine tape to see how it's handed out.
Yeah, it's what the referee sees and what he anticipates. Sometimes you'll have a referee ask a player if he touched it or not. But to me, it looked like Dupuis got a body part on that.
At this point, guys, I don't think they really care. It's all about the group at this stage of the season. We'd be happy to give it to Hossa.
This one ricocheted right back in and is eventually settled down and twisted around behind by Smith. It was 17 years ago yesterday that a Penguin team was leaving Pittsburgh and in the final against the Minnesota North Stars after having played two here and divided them. They lost that game three in Minnesota, and then they won the next three for a championship in 1991. Swept Chicago in 92. Back-to-back Stanley Cups. And many players always talk about the fact you just think they're going to come more often because they came very quickly. Same happened with the Flyers. This is carried back in by Prospel, and his shot is stopped and held by Fleury.
Maybe the year after that, Doc, when they tried to go for the hat trick, might have been their best team that they had had, but they end up losing in seven games. An overtime goal to the New York Islanders by David Volek, and from our Navy net cam, a lot of pucks in behind Martin Biron.
Jimmy Dowd on this faceoff win. And Parent with a shot off the glass. Dowd once more, and that one blocked, and then helped back along by Crosby, but kept by Tiemannin for a shot that's wide, and sent along by Letang. Good hustle by Jim Dowd again, played that in front. Letang was watching, and it spirited back out. Hossa lobbed it ahead. Crosby after that puts on the brakes and holds through traffic. Crosby feathered it through, and it's off the stick of Hossa. Regained again, though, and Hossa dropped it on to Dupuis. We yanked it around behind, Hossa turning there, but couldn't come up with it. Tiemannin could, and pulls away. 34 years ago tomorrow, Rick McLeese scored a goal against Boston in Philadelphia. The first championship for the Flyers, and it was a guy named Perron, rather than pronounced Perron, who made the difference as the MVP. They had a championship there next year, too. None since. Icing touch-up. 13:34 to go in the third. The Penguins with a half dozen and lead by the same number. In the early years of the franchise, 7,200 was a pretty good crowd. 17,000 plus for the last 64 games. All is different now. There's a future here. There were spotty times in the earlier years. And Jack Riley, the highly esteemed general manager of the first year team, watching here. A shot by Malone went off his skate and then has popped up in the air. Great to get his wisdom on not only the early years of the team, but also he's been based here in Pittsburgh ever since and has had a chance to watch the evolution of this franchise, several of its declines and several of its financial troubles from a distance, and then to come here and watch this team headed to an apparent Stanley Cup final. 6-0. Penguins have the lead with a little under 13 minutes to go. This is grabbed off now by Orpik and Gonchar. I don't know if you're thinking this far ahead. I guess there's a temptation if you're a Penguins fan. There was no play between the Atlantic and Central divisions. So in case you're thinking ahead and you think it might be a Pittsburgh-Detroit final, there's nothing to base any kind of season series on because they never played. Only twice in the last 3 years, centering pass goes wide. This is brought back ahead now and carried on by Jarkko Ruutu and then twisted back in.
You know what, Doc, and Mike, I'd be interested in what you think as well. I mean, once you get to the Stanley Cup Finals, really, I mean, a lot of things have changed. They've added players, you've had injuries. Really doesn't matter. Again, now it just comes down to the execution on the ice of coaches. Will prepare the players, be able to go over the game plan, strengths, weaknesses, what they like to do, and especially teams' even strength. But again, if it comes down to that execution from playoff time and obviously in the Stanley Cup Finals.
The interesting thing, though, guys, it's every time you get a new dance partner, you have to learn new moves. It'll be interesting to see whoever Pittsburgh matches up again, just how it goes in the early going, so it sets the tone.
They played the Dallas Stars this year, the Penguins did, and they won that game. As ahead with this now comes Jones. George Laroque comes to the bench, turned over to Talbot, down to the ice. Jones trying to hold his man off was Hatcher. His brother Kevin once played here as a member of the Pittsburgh Penguins. This is flown right back in, and Orpik will go to get it.
It was actually traded for Sergei Zubov. Now still patrolling the blue line for Dave Tippett, the Dallas Stars.
Kevin had a long time career in the NHL, but that was the last year of it. He retired after that, but As you mentioned, Zuboff was a younger man, and he still is playing like a young man there for the Stars. This is on now to Jason Smith. Laid back across now for a return by Kukkonen. We mentioned those championship teams that the Flyers had in the mid-70s. They were coached by a bespectacled guy who was very well-spoken and interesting, always to listen to, the late Fred Shiro. Puck played to the outside now and worked off the stick of Kennedy and turned back out. And with Fred here, he would be very proud of what his son has done against his old team. Ray, the general manager here for the Pittsburgh Penguins, just sent back up the boards and turned back on for an outlet pass that's across to Tiemannin. Tiemannin showing a lot of courage. He said before the game he was quite nervous today on how all of this would go. But let's check in again with Mike.
You know, Doc, it's not going to end well here for the Philadelphia Flyers, but for Kimo Tiemannin, you have to give him a tremendous amount of credit. Just 2 weeks ago, faced with a life-threatening situation with a blood clot, he's managed to climb back into this and participate in this conference final. Got to give him all the credit in the world. And the Flyers, for that matter, they've been a real frisky bunch all year long. They're going to the wire with this one. It's not going to end happily, as I said, but a tremendous year for the Philadelphia Flyers.
Yeah, Paul Holmgren's done a heck of a job here retooling his team at the end of last year, moving players out, getting draft picks, being real active come free agency, as we talked about in that intermission. Dead last year in the National Hockey League, and here they are, three wins away from getting to the Stanley Cup Finals. Tremendous job all the way around. It all started with Paul Holmgren.
Here's Carter, a shot, and a pad stop is made by Fleury with a little over 9.5 to go in this.
You can see down here, guys, the sense of inevitable amongst the Philadelphia Flyers players. As good a season as it's been, it's still tough to finish with a loss.
Scorching shot by Whitney was padded by Veron. Well, the last time we were here for a Flyers-Penguins game, it was in March. Flyers lost that game 7-1, and everything looked shaky. But then they were able to hold off the Atlanta Thrashers back in Philadelphia, and the rest of their season took an upward turn.
With Antero Mitomaki as your goaltender in that game.
You're right. Oh, a shot off the pipe from Rob Scuderi has the crowd buzzing. And while you talk about a rebound, and maybe going in as one of the underdog teams, and they faced Washington in a thriller in 7 games. Meanwhile, this is brought back out by Maxim Talbot.
That series easily could have been a 4-game sweep, Doc.
By
the Flyers.
Because they had the lead in
early.
Washington
the first four
back.
Games. I mean, they dominated pretty much the first 4 games of that series. Got up, lost the first game up after being up 2-0 going into the third. They won the next three and then found themselves in that 7th game. Overtime winner for Joffrey Lupul.
Well, it has to be tremendous day for the Penguins because they have come back here at home. They will now go into the final having won 8 and having won 16 games in a row on their own ice. I hope I have the name right. I'll have to double check. Gonchar with a shot that deflected wide. And the number's impressive for Fleury. It would be 18 straight for him in wins here over a 6-month span. Is deflected wide by Fleury. Marc-Andre is trying to go after the third for goaltender gurus unmentionable in the playoffs. They're always superstitious about that. And another superstition that the Penguins will be dealing with will be the presentation of the Prince of Wales trophy after the game is over, because that, ever since the mid-90s, it has been something that you just don't deal with. The one you want to touch is the Stanley Cup. You don't even do anything more than pose nicely next to a trophy that symbolizes you're going to get to the final. And even when Eric Staal brought the Stanley Cup to the Staal residence, Jordan, who carries the puck now, did not touch it. Didn't you, as a teenager, think you could, you know, mimic your brother by picking up the Stanley Cup and holding it over your head? Nope. Oh, by no means. I didn't get close to it.
There's a guy that knows the history of the National Hockey League. They want to come within 10 feet of it, let alone touch.
This goes on back deeper now for the play of Kukkonen as we're down to the last 6:35.
Well, the Penguins had their adversity during the regular season. They lost Sidney Crosby with the ankle injury. They lost Marc-Andre Fleury. Ty Conklin came in and just did a phenomenal job of giving this team an opportunity to be in every game with consistent goaltending.
That's a great point, Edzo. It was Ryan Malone that had him as the team MVP during that stretch.
Should be 6-1, but for Fleury, denying Carter.
Right pad save, moving left to right. Carter not able to elevate the puck. Outstanding stop there by Marc-Andre Fleury.
Crossbow a shot, and that one high and wide. Ruutu lobbed it along, and again it will go back down, and this time it'll be for an icing touch-up. Marc-Andre has faced 18. He has gotten 18, and the best one was number 18. 6-0 his team. Stanley Cup Final is coming up next week, 8 Eastern Time, Game 3 and 4, and if necessary, 5, 6, and 7. And there is Ray Shiro. He's been hard for us to catch because he moves in and out of the booth where they are sitting in there, Mario Lemieux and his wife Natalie. Mario inducted into the International Ice Hockey Hall of Fame this past week, along with Art Berglund, longtime USA hockey representative, Philippe Bozon of the French Olympic team and of the St. Louis Blues at one time, Tammy Granato, the patron saint of U.S. women's hockey, Angela James and Geraldine Haney from Canada's team, and a shot ricocheted wide. And it continues to be a zero on one side of the board with 5 minutes and 10 seconds to go in the third. Jones with the long pass. Hatcher sent it on. Carried back in by Leupold. Met there by Talbot. Slipped back along, but not out. Kept by Hatcher, but they rule an offside. We should mention, too, we've talked about Wilkes-Barre Scranton. That team is still in the American Hockey League playoffs in their conference final against Anaheim's team, the Portland Pirates. And they're playing today in the afternoon in Portland with the series best of 7-1-1. Hoping to earn a ride into that final in the American League against the winner of the Toronto Marlies Chicago Wolves series, which is Chicago 1 and Toronto nothing. Pretty big city series in the American League.
Farm team of the Atlanta Thrashers. Chicago Wolves, John Anderson looking for another championship down in the American Hockey League.
Well, there's a guy that will, you would think, will soon have his chance in the NHL as a coach. How many would this be for him? I mean, he consistently gets his team to the final, it seems. But anyway,
it could be the fourth one if they can win it this year.
All right. That's long. 6-0, Penguins.
We'll go back to the middle of the second period. A 2-0 lead for the Penguins. A shot by Danny Briere and an opportunistic opportunity for Scott Hartnell. Great left pad save for Marc-Andre Fleury. He saves the key time. That's what you need come playoff time, and only 4:42 away for the Penguins head to the Stanley Cup Final.
It is Orpik starting ahead. And Orpik skipped one back in that Biron will stop behind. Ricocheted off a stick to be played back along by Orpik, but it caromed out of play. Here is our Dodge Journey breakthrough line of the game. Pascal Dupuis, Sidney Crosby, and Marian Hossa. And you see their production.
Yeah, Pascal Dupuis not only using his speed to forecheck, but also very physical. 5 hits for Pascal Dupuis. Of course, Crosby going to the net, couple assists. And Marian Hossa, really that backbreaker after the Crosby back check, the third goal of the game, and made that beautiful pass to Hossa, the short side. That was a soft goal given up by Marty Biron, and he showed the big save by Fleury. That's where the Flyers needed a big stop there from Biron.
Boy, just complete turnovers by the Flyers, but the Penguins just pressing and pressing, and Biron was able to hold the ball off in a three-shot combination. Now Gonchar, that one is swept angrily back out by Mike Richards, who comes to the bench for another change, and 3:50 left. Conference final in the history of the franchise for the sixth time. Twice out of that, they got to the Stanley Cup Final, and both of those times they won. Played back one now by Jones, and Then scrap for at center, forced along by Kennedy, and with speed moving in and twisting along is Crosby, laying it right back in again. Dupuy turning with it there. Dupuy able to step along and has Crosby nearby. Plays it on back to Scuderi. Crosby stood up a bit by the deep checking of Jim Dow. Turned along by Crosby. And forced on to Dupuy. Away from Hossa. Then Crosby, and getting a piece of it was Biron. Under 3 minutes to go. The depth at center that the Penguins have, and that includes Maxim Talbot. It's pretty good to have a guy like that as your fourth line centerman, if that's how you count them up, with Stahl behind Crosby and Malkin.
Now you think about the heyday, you had Lemieux, you had Francis, you had Trottier there as well. The one thing the Penguins didn't have for a long period of time, they just did not have any center icemen. Let alone were good defensively, but weren't able to create and distribute. You need strength in the middle, plus they have size with Malkin and Stahl.
Here's a shot by Carter that got the glass. Michael Therrien said he has been greatly influenced in his coaching career as well as a player by Jacques Lemaire and the defensive scheme that he brought into the NHL with New Jersey, with a team that historians often forget led the league in goals scored in the year 2000. By that time, Jacques had gone. Larry Robinson was the coach of the team that won there. But he continues to preach that defensive style in Minnesota, where he will be continuing as coach. Centering pass came back out. A chance for Kukkonen. And Kukkonen has drawn a penalty to the Penguins with a minute and 40 seconds to go. Mike, what are you seeing, hearing, and thinking?
You know, today's a big game. Obviously, it's an elimination game for the Pittsburgh Penguins. And in big games, you want your big players to play their best. Today, no question that the big players for the Flyers came. Here's Evgeny Malkin with a goal on the stuff. A great back check here by Crosby. That's what you want your big players to do. And Marc-Andre Fleury with the big saves. And then to top it off, Crosby to Hossa. Pretty sweet. Big players showing up today.
Adam Hall has been given the hooking penalty, the power play sponsored by Dockers. Saw Sidney Crosby looking on. Captain of the Penguins. Youngest NHL captain ever. He was a teenager when he got the job. And the fans here are all standing. They have sat during the entire game, stood only when necessary, and now they think it's necessary, and why not? Not urged on by any scoreboard. They're just saluting their team for another thrilling afternoon. That one is held by Fleury. All four of the teams in this final, including Evgeny Malkin's, have great futures because of the young talent that they have. Dallas Stars, Detroit Red Wings, they're not old teams. And the same is true for Pittsburgh and Philadelphia. Good chance they can all be back here. Maybe not all together in 1 year, but on a regular basis to be deep in the playoffs, as Biron flings that one behind.
They only have to be smart in trading and signing of free agents. But in the new era we live in, when it comes to the salary cap, you have to draft well. All four of those teams have certainly done that.
It is Jones shaking loose. Tried to get it in front, could not. Jones again, stopped by Fleury. Rebound, another shot by Prostful, careened across, and a diving hack of the puck down the ice by Talbot. 23 left. Prostful brings it on and drops to Umberger. That one came around in front, denied by Gill and cleared. Marc-Andre Fleury will have his third shutout. And the Penguins will be in the Stanley Cup Final for the first time since 1992.
Third period, shots on goal, Philadelphia 8, Pittsburgh 6.
These coaches that have waged a war of bench jockeying and all of the things you have to think about as a coach shake hands after having met for the 52nd time, and they're both still young men. Confetti raining down here at Mellon Arena as the Flyers patiently, politely wait for the celebration by the Penguins. And then the old routine that is known only to this sport. All of it melts in handshakes at center ice. Rob Scuderi is the first to offer his hand of congratulations as you see Talbot and Fleury, and they proceed through the line. Evgeny Malkin was a target. He was worked over pretty thoroughly. The question was, when Pittsburgh got through this series, how healthy would they be going into the final? Pretty healthy. Sidney Crosby getting congratulations.
It was a player, a marquee player along with Sidney Crosby, you know. And when teams challenge those types of players, Doc, they want to see the reaction. Is the guy going to fall and not fight back? And not from a sense of dropping the gloves, but how is he going to compete? And you use it as a strategy to try and get under the skin and make it difficult. And you have to target those guys. Because if you allow guys like Crosby, like Malkin, room out there, they're going to make you pay. And you're not going to shut those guys down. You like to limit their opportunities. And you have to be hard on the body.
Marty Biron, what a gallant performer he was through these playoffs, fashioning a playoff reputation of his own here in winning two series. Now a couple of the guys who were at the forefront of this important game today. Crosby with primary assists, Malone with a couple of goals, and Mike Milbury is downstairs with Sidney Crosby.
Sidney, that's as good as it gets today. I mean, a perfect performance from your team.
Yeah, we got a great start, and we didn't let our foot off the gas. We made sure that we kept coming, and everyone contributed. Everyone bought into what we had to do, and it's a great game for us.
Well, was there a turning point during the year, a time when you really felt this was a season you could make a bid for a cup win?
I don't think there was ever a point, but I think we showed guts all year. We faced a lot of adversity, and you just got to battle through it. Our guys have done a great job of sticking together no matter what happens, and we got to continue this year for another round.
Your goaltender's taken it to a new level, has he not?
Yeah, he's been great for us all year, and we've been confident with him, but come playoff time, you need goaltending to be a little bit extra better than normal, and he's definitely answered the call.
Congratulations. Doc, back to you.
The fans continue to celebrate here, some of them wearing those powdered blue jerseys that were made famous not only by the early team, but even more so by the performance of the team wearing them in an outdoor game on January 1st in Buffalo. Mike's downstairs with Marc-Andre Fleury.
It's a long way from draft day, number one overall. It took you a few years to hit your stride, but this has got to be pretty special.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's the best time I've ever had in hockey, you know, to be with this bunch of guys. And we're having so much fun right now, so it's pretty awesome.
You know, you at 2-0, you flashed out the pads a couple of times and made some great saves. Did you know it? You had it then? You know your focus was on?
I think from the beginning of the game, I could just see the player how well they were playing, and I wasn't worried about at all. Everybody was pretty confident we could win that game tonight.
Congratulations. Enjoy. Great performance. Doc?
That was at the end as Marc-Andre Fleury celebrated getting to the final. And by the way, a third shutout. Ray Shero shaking hands with the personnel in the Pittsburgh Penguins booth.
Yeah, assistant general manager Chuck Fletcher, Tommy Fitzgerald as well. Couple days off for the Penguins, and get ready to find out who they're going to take on in a Stanley Cup final.
The man who ended the last series in overtime against the Rangers, Marian Hossa. Marcel's probably watching. Marian downstairs with Mike Milbury, or maybe his brother.
Come a long way from the deadline. You know, did you expect to get here once you were traded to the Penguins?
Well, this is a dream come true, being traded in a team, and right now we're going to the Stanley Cup final. What a feeling.
You know, when you first got here, it seemed like you didn't really have your stride. It didn't seem like you were in the swing of things. But as time went on, you really looked like you feel much more at home.
Definitely. Sometimes you take a time to adjust. And it took me a little bit. But right now, I feel like at home. And I'm just happy to be here.
Congratulations. Go have some fun.
Doc, back to you.
Captain Sidney Crosby.
Bill Daly, the deputy commissioner of the National Hockey League, is going to present the Prince of Wales trophy to Sidney Crosby. That's a polite distance, isn't it?
Respectfully to Bill Daly.
Yes. It'll be here for you when you want it. Somebody else will carry it off. So Sid the Kid captained this team through three rounds of the playoffs now, and Marc-Andre Fleury with a huge grin on his face. At only age 23, he has backstopped his team into the Stanley Cup final. And today, 21 he faced, 21 he got in his third shutout of a very brief career when it comes to being in the playoffs.
Well, if there's any doubt, we talked about Marty Turco a little bit earlier, Doc. Marc-Andre Fleury, the first pick overall in the 2003 entry draft, the Pittsburgh Penguins, then general manager Craig Patrick, who deserves a lot of credit with his staff, Mark Kelly, Greg Malone, and now with the new regime here with Ray Sherro and Chuck Fletcher, drafting Brooks Orpik, Scuderi, Whitney, Letang, Malkin, Crosby, Malone, Talbot, you can go on and on. But the ability to be able to be patient, have a plan, stay with it. But Marc-Andre Fleury, no doubt, has had the ability, but you have to have patience. And he has given the Pittsburgh Penguins consistency. And contrary to what a lot of people have said and believe, he was not rushed to the National Hockey League. There was patience in his first year, 9 games his rookie year. The next year, there was no National Hockey League. The third year, he didn't come up until the end of January. So that is not rushing a young player, especially a goaltender. Last year, 40 wins, the Penguins making the playoffs, and now getting to the Stanley Cup final 5 years later after a young goaltender that was drafted number one overall back in 2003, Marc-Andre Fleury.
Mike Milbury downstairs.
Ryan, this is the team you grew up watching your whole life, and try to tell me what it feels like right now.
Surreal. I think you just go out, and it just seems like kind of another big game, but... You know, we'll see what happens here with the other two teams battling over in the West. And, you know, I don't know what to say right now. Just kind of got the goosebumps and excited for the next step.
Is there something about the team? There was as much energy on that bench today as I've seen in a long time. And you knew you had to close it out here at home?
Yeah, we know, you know, Philly's a tough place to play. We definitely want to go back there. You know, we thought, you know, all year long when our backs were hanging so well with a bad game, we bounced back with a great performance. And, you know, once again, we did it here tonight. And I think that's, you know, why we're in the position we're in.
And your goaltender, he's taken it to a new level. At 2-0, flashed out the pads, made some great saves, and kept it out of their reach.
Oh, yeah, definitely. That's what he's been doing all playoffs long. He makes those key saves at the right time. And, you know, what can you say about him? He's definitely, you know, taking his game to another level.
Congratulations. Thanks a lot. Doctor.
Well, it is not easy duty to pull for a representative of the team, but there's been no more upfront guy for the Philadelphia Flyers this year than Mike Richards. Bob Neumeier speaks with him.
Well, thanks, Doc. Mike, you've been in the dressing room. You've had some words with your teammates. Could you tell us the communication, what you told your teammates after this hockey game this afternoon?
Well, we're extremely disappointed to be out, but, I mean, we battled our hardest in the playoffs. It's tough going through the playoffs, playing a number three seed, number one seed, and now the number two seed. So, I mean, it's disappointing, but, I mean, it was a good playoff run for us.
All right, losing is losing, no matter where you are, and only one team's going to win the Stanley Cup. Would you rather have been beaten 4-3 in triple overtime than the kind of game we saw that you lost today?
You know what? Today just wasn't our day. You know, you have great days, you have bad days, and then you have in-between days, and today just wasn't our day, and give them credit. They came out strong, and, I mean, they played well.
All right, put your handicapper's cap on for a moment and let us know how you think the Penguins can fare against either the Detroit Red Wings or the Dallas Stars. Can they win the Stanley Cup?
Well, I mean, they have a good team. I've only played Dallas this year. I haven't seen much of them, so I can't handicap that. But, I mean, the Penguins definitely have a good team. They got strong goaltending and good forwards, and their defense is underrated. They play a very well, very good defensive game, and you know, they have a good team.
All right, one last question quickly. Can you summarize your season? I know it's been up and down, you know, up early, and then a life and death to make the playoffs. How would you summarize the Flyers' season?
Like you said, up and down, through all the adversity, through all the highs and lows. It's great to see that this team can go through some of the adversity that we had challenged and thrown in our way. And I had probably one of the funnest years I've had, just, you know, being around the guys, the success, the ups and downs. I wouldn't trade it. And I'm extremely happy with the team.
As you might understand, Doc, an empty feeling around the Flyer dressing room here this afternoon.
Indeed, but we sure appreciate Mike for coming out. 23 years of age, his third year in Philadelphia. What a future he has with that team. As you see, the finish of all of this, 85-6. 8-5-6, the winning percentage for the Penguins in the playoffs. Most teams will be glad to take that as they go to the Stanley Cup Final. When they return to the ice, it'll be either Game 1 if it's against Dallas, or Game 3 if it's against Detroit here.